In the year 1927, Carl Breer lived in this house on Boston Boulevard in Detroit, Michigan, and during the summer would commute on weekends to a cottage he rented at Gratiot Beach, about 60 miles away. This cottage gave his family a chance to enjoy the beauty of Lake Huron. It was during one of these commutes that he sighted what he first thought was a flock of geese, but as they got closer, turned out to be a squadron of Army airplanes. This set him to wondering about the aerodynamics of the current automobile, which hadn't been taken very seriously by the industry. In the meantime, as you can see, his family was thoroughly enjoying the water wonderland, in this case, powered by a Chrysler Marine engine. A wind tunnel was designed and built thanks to the help of Orville Wright, the father of aviation. Carl Breer assigned one of his engineers, Bill Earnshaw, to work with Mr. Wright, and the tunnel was soon installed at the Chrysler Highland Park Engineering Center. A variety of scale model automobiles were built and tested for wind resistance. Not only did they style cars in the shape of the day, but they also had some very streamlined styled cars here. The one being tested now by engineer Ray Hotel was dubbed the Trifon and was later built as a full-scale prototype. The white string flapping in the breeze at the rear of the car is there to give an indication as to the flow of the air. Mr. Breer is shown here with his chief stylist, Oliver Clark, discussing the building of the Trifon model. And now you see a photograph of the actual Trifon prototype car. This was taken December the 9th, 1932, about 2 years before the actual airflow production began. I'm happy to say that the original test Trifon was never destroyed, and it's presently owned and preserved by Bruce Thomas, a retired Chrysler engineer, who currently works part-time as historian for the corporation. That was a view of the engine compartment and then the undercarriage. They took a lot of photographs. This one, of course, is the interior. And the instrument panel is shown here with all the gauges and the Philco radio. That was a very unusual looking armrest. I've never seen one made in a circular fashion like that. They didn't take a lot of pains with the upholstering on the interior because this was a test vehicle. A rear differential and drive shaft. Not much trunk room left after that spare tire is installed. A view of the wheelhouse and suspension. Now this picture was taken up near the Chrysler Secret Airflow Test Headquarters. Their first test site was Struble's Farm near the Rifle River in West Branch, Michigan. They had to transport these cars from the Highland Park headquarters to the Northern Michigan site. They didn't want people to see what it looked like, so they had to carry it in a van, a closed van. One of the roads up north, look at that old gas station with the hand pumps for the gasoline. A couple of schoolboys looking at the car and remarking how different it looked to them. In those days, they made full-scale models out of wood. And these are some stylists that are working on a wooden model here. That was at the Highland Park engineering facility. Studies on structures, which had to do with the unique construction of the body and chassis being all one unit. More pictures back at the Struble farm. In 1931 and 1932, all of the testing was done out of Struble's farm. But later on, as road test activities increased, they needed more room. So eventually they rented Joe Meade's farm about 6 miles southeast of West Branch. That was late in 1932. Here they're still at the Struble farm. Couple of bird hunters. The local people that saw the car were amazed. It was so different looking from the vehicles of the day. Chrysler had its own photographic studio and took all their own pictures. That's quite a contrast between the horse and wagon and that Trifon. This bridge went over the Rifle River, so they took some pictures of the test vehicle going over that. They had altered the original Trifon, as you can see. The front end is quite a bit different than the original. It's more attractive looking. The grill is different there. All the roads were gravel, so it generated quite a bit of dust. And they did a lot of night testing. Now they had moved to Joe Meade's farm, and there was a fire, and it destroyed some of the building, but the barn was left and some of the outbuildings. This picture was taken November 15th of 1933. There wasn't any notes left as to what caused the fire. Look at that old cast iron stove. Looks like the fire really did a lot of damage. Mr. Meade here, he was 76 years old in 1933. And a fellow by the name of Lennox here, one of the engineers, who was consoling Mr. Meade. At the same time all this airflow development work was going on, Mr. Breer designed and had a small car built for his oldest son, Fred. used a Briggs & Stratton 5-horsepower gasoline engine linked to some surplus parts, namely axles, 3-speed transmission, steering gear, propeller shaft, levers, etc., from a small car called the Mathias, M-A-T-H-I-S, that Willie Durant, founder of GM, had planned to build in Lansing, Michigan in 1930, but it never got off the ground. That's Brother Fred driving my youngest brother, Tom, and mother around the backyard at Boston Boulevard. And here's Dad. He had to give it a try as well. Looks like he was quite pleased with the outcome. And later the same year, a friend of Dad's, Mr. Henry Hund, who headed up Briggs Manufacturing, a large auto body building company of the day, said he would like to make a body for the little car, and this is the end result. We recently gave this miniature car to Chrysler's historical group, who are now in the process of restoring it for their collection. And that's Fred driving me in the back seat with our Cocker Spaniel. The car on the left is, I believe, an English Austin. Dad used to bring home competitors' cars occasionally to check them out. The gentleman on the left was Fred M. Zeter, my uncle. The one in the middle, Walter Chrysler, and my dad, Carl Breer, was on the right. This is another picture of the three of them. And this is Carl Breer in the back seat showing how smooth the ride was. He could read a Wall Street Journal. Now, there were quite a few publicity photos taken at different points, mostly in the Detroit, Michigan area. Some of these were taken in Bloomfield Hills, and some of them, that's probably in Metamora, Michigan, where they do a lot of hunting on horseback. These were all publicity photos used at the introduction of the car. I'm not sure how many of them they actually used. That outdoor scene could very well be either Grosse Pointe or Bloomfield Hills. X8600, I suppose the X on the license plate stands for experimental, but at that stage it was no longer experimental. These are the first production vehicles. That looks like a courtyard in some estate. Yeah, it really looks shiny there. Pretty trees in the background. These scenes out in the country could very well have been in the Metamora area, because shortly you'll see a couple of pheasant hunters. Yeah, this looks like Metamora hunt country. See a horse in the background. There's your pheasant hunter with a pretty Irish setter, it looks like. That's an English setter, I believe, there. A couple of nice pheasants. This is the big CW airflow, 1934 CW, with a one-piece front windshield. Beautiful car, very spacious. They only built a few of these. Dad had one for his personal car. That was a CU, I believe. If these cars were the really streamlined ones where there was no tire on the rear and the sloping rear was extremely streamlined. Standard Oil had several of these tankers built, and I know Texaco also did. In fact, today you can go to the Henry Ford Museum and see one of the Texaco airflow tankers. This was quite a unique vehicle. It was built for sightseeing in the western Sierra Nevada mountain area. They put several sections into the center of an airflow to extend its length. In November 1933, this magazine article appeared showing Harry Hartz, a noted race pilot and automotive engineer, driving a typically styled car of the day in reverse direction to prove that current shapes were all wrong, since this vehicle had 20% less wind resistance, burned less fuel, and had higher top speed. He had all of the controls and drivetrain modified in order to do this. This was a prelude to the airflow introduction. In June of 1934, Chrysler was doing further testing on more advanced streamlining. This test car was given a five-piece front windshield to assimilate curved glass, and the rear end was checked out with three different configurations. The first design had a blunt cut-off rear, the second a pointed tailpiece, and there was a third construction of which I have no photograph. It was described as an extremely long detachable tail supported by a third wheel underneath it. This last construction, which would not be practical in a production vehicle, did, however, prove that it would give the ultimate low coefficient of drag, since the top speed without the tail was about 60 miles per hour, but with the long tail it gave a top speed of over 100 miles per hour. September 23, 1936, Carl Breer and his wife left New York Harbor on the Queen Mary, bound for the port of Cherbourg in France. They planned to attend the International Auto Show in Paris and then tour Europe in a Chrysler Airflow. It took several days crossing the ocean, and they had a very pleasant trip. enjoying the deck chairs. And being September, the weather was still not too cold. Nice big promenade deck. They're looking at their ship in the harbor now, and they've arrived in Cherbourg. They are met by a gentleman from Chrysler Export by the name of Mr. DeMuller. He escorts them to Paris, where they visit the beautiful Palace of Versailles. They took these and many more pictures of the beautiful formal gardens and the lovely palace. And it's here where they're met by Rene, their chauffeur, and a brand new airflow which will transport them through the whole countryside. They're at Malmaison here, Napoleon's home, where these graceful swans are part of the scenery. One of the fellows that grooms all those beautiful gardens. Here we have Carl Breer posing with a group of Chrysler Export people just outside of the Grand Palace where the automobile show is being held. Downtown Paris. It's a magnificent structure still there today. I don't know when it was built, but it's been there for many, many centuries. And now we're looking at some of the Chrysler automobiles. Here with Mr. Breer, his wife, and a cousin. He's standing up on the balcony taking this picture. Right down below are all the Chrysler products. And then a lot of these names are no longer in existence. Many of the companies are gone. Peugeot, that's still around. In these scenes, I only see one Chrysler Airflow, and that's the one right up in the upper part of the picture, the black one. Another view of the great building here with all the names. Now there is some streamlined looking automobile. Mercedes, Benz, and Fiat, they're still around. That's a pretty little red thing there. I don't know what line of vehicles this was, but they all had three windshield wipers, something sort of unique. That's that racy looking little red car. This just shows that the Tucker Torpedo wasn't the first one to have a Cyclops headlight in the middle. We're looking at the outside of the palace where the President of France is exiting and getting into that limo, and then one of the generals also. A typical street scene in downtown Paris in 1936. It's really interesting to look at the automobiles of the day. Not only automobiles, but they had a lot of horses and buggies and carts running around downtown. You can well imagine what the airflow looked like in comparison to all those cars when people saw it. Some of the buses they had were interesting looking. They had an observation platform out on the back. There one goes by right then. They've come to the Eiffel Tower. Every tourist has to visit that. Tour Eiffel, as they call it in France. And then the Arc de Triomphe. The eternal flame for the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. They traveled to another part of France. Little old woman. This is the Graf Zeppelin coming in from South America, a German aircraft of the day. A typical scene out in the countryside in those days. The airflow is coming down through these beautiful trees. This was a community wash basin where all of the ladies would do their wash and gossip about what's going on around town. They've come to the town of Pisa in Italy, and there's the Leaning Tower of Pisa in the background, still leaning today. We've come to the Vatican. And there's the airflow, the modern and the ancient. After leaving the Vatican in Rome, they visit the Prince and Princess Orsini at their home, which was built in 1400. I love the way the prince dropped his monocle out. This home is about an hour's drive from Rome. The Princess Orsini was a cousin of Dad's. You get a view of his old home there up on the top of the terraced hill. Back in Rome, this is Mussolini's headquarters of the day. He used to speak from that balcony. I couldn't resist taking sections out of Dad's tape of all the old cars driving in these downtown cities. They were brand new cars in their day. A lot more modern than this kind of a vehicle. But then you have the airflow in the background, and you can see the contrast there. It's extreme. They've come to Venezia. They're enjoying a wonderful gondola ride. Now we jump to Austria. And these Austrian gentlemen are looking over the airflow. And Dad couldn't resist getting a picture of this lady's hat. Her husband with a handlebar mustache is trying to talk her into posing for him. He finally convinced her to do it. Isn't that a headpiece? Now we're in Vienna, Austria. And mother getting into the airflow. Parked outside of their hotel, the Bristol. Hotel Bristol in Vienna. There's Renee holding the door open. We've come to London at the Chrysler factory there. Their showroom. And then this is the plant outside of the showroom. Looks a little foggy, which is pretty typical of London. These are the King's Mounted Light Guards. And mother and dad are chatting with a Mr. Strickland of Ford Motor. Changing the guards at Buckingham Palace. That still goes on today. It's October the 28th, 1936. They have arrived in Berlin and stayed at the Adlon Hotel. It was Hitler's heyday at this time, and here's a rare picture of Adolf leaving the balcony at the House of Propaganda, and Propaganda Minister Goebbels right behind him, where he had just given the Nazi salute. And now the crowd down below is saluting the celebrities as they come out. And here comes Adolf himself giving that Heil Hitler as he leaves in that brown uniform to the left. All the officers running after him. Other officials being seen are Propaganda Minister Goebbels again, Hermann Goering, Max Schmeling, and so forth. These fellows look like they might be SS troopers. I'm not sure. It isn't close enough to tell. But I do remember fighting these guys back in the war. Another official leaving in a big Mercedes open touring sedan. Little did I know at this time that in 1944 and 45 I'd be over there fighting these fellows. Here's Hermann Goering leaving in the limo. Another Mercedes open sedan. The Nazis were celebrating the 10th anniversary of their coming to power, so they had all these parades going on. Just look at all those swastikas. They were all hung out for that anniversary. That's one side of the street, and then you'll have a look at the other side of the street with the same sort of thing, all those banners hanging. On October 31st, they took to the Autobahn, which I believe was the first superhighway ever built. Then they came to the Rhine River, where a large sidewheeler with twin boilers was pulling a string of barges. One of the stops was a little town of Oberwarsheim in Germany, and this is where my grandmother was born. The airflow pulled quite an interested crowd in that little town. Quite a combination here with a horse and a steer pulling a honey wagon. Those honey wagons are carrying liquid fertilizer. Finally, on November the 4th, they leave Europe from the harbor of Le Havre, France, aboard the Normandy. Carl Breer was presented with a life membership in the Airflow Club of America. He was very proud of that honor. This meet was held at Chrysler Corporation Engineering Headquarters, which at the time was located in Highland Park, Michigan, a suburb not far from downtown Detroit. There was a very good attendance of people from the club, and they had some beautifully restored cars. This picture shows Carl Breer with Paul Ackerman. Mr. Ackerman was the chief engineer of Chrysler at that time. Mr. Breer in one of the cars. He had a leopard skin upholstering. This was an Airstream that just happened to be there. On the left to right, you have Vice President of the Airflow Club, E. Wallace Norman, and then the President, Lewis Hammond, and then, of course, Carl Breer. This close-up shows Mr. Breer with Mr. Norman and Mr. Ackerman. The person on the extreme right is Mr. James Zeter, brother-in-law of Carl Breer. Mr. Ackerman giving an address with the group at a luncheon. The speaker's table. Carl Breer giving his address. And he was presented with this beautiful plaque by the Airflow Club. A year or two before the Airflow meet, Carl Breer purchased this beautiful DeSoto from the original owner in Toledo, Ohio. Everything on the car was factory original. Nonetheless, Mr. Breer took it to the Chrysler factory and they put some finishing touches on it. And today that same car is in the Chrysler Historical Collection. You can see the upholstering, the interior, just the way it was when he took delivery. And that's even the original running board rubber, which is something to be well preserved. Mr. Breer in his beautiful CW Airflow limousine parked in front of his Grosse Pointe, Michigan home. And it was here that the renowned artist Klaus Oldenburg came to visit with a request to study the car firsthand so he could apply his abstract expressionism to the machine and its components. He is famous for his soft artistic renditions of objects such as these. Here Claus and his wife are showing my younger brother Bob one of his preliminary sketches of the CW. Bob, by the way, is an artist of long standing and a personal friend of Claus. Dad visited his New York studio and saw some of the work that he was doing in preparation for the final art objects. It's amazing how much preliminary work that he had to go through in order to come up with the final renditions. And I'm going to show you an excerpt from an art magazine that gives an idea of just what's involved. These are some photographs of his soft art as produced applying to the airflow components, along with captions from those photographs. I must admit that these renditions of airflow components don't resemble the actual parts very accurately, but then they aren't supposed to since they are abstracts. The fact that they were created by one so prominent in the art world has to be another plus for the airflow. This is kind of a freehand sketch that he made of the front end of the airflow. And these are some of his typical art objects, like that big piece of cake and the toothpaste tube. And here you see him knee-deep in wedding cakes. Bruce Thomas and Gid Hershoff left Grosse Pointe with Mr. Breer in his CW bound for Dayton. They've arrived and they're in front of the Imperial House Motel. And in this view, Fred Rieger is on the left. Fred was the vice president of the Airflow Club and he hosted the meet. Here he is with his wife. And then another view of Fred and his Airflow. A highlight of the meet was a visit to the Air Force Museum at Patterson Field. Mr. Breer is visiting here with Colonel Joe Hornsby, director of the museum. The front entrance of the museum. And that happens to be myself. I went over to attend the meeting and thoroughly enjoyed it. A view of all the cars lined up ready for inspection. A proud owner and his wife from West Virginia. This is Max Stewart. He's an engineer from Chrysler. A father and son with their well-restored car and parts for sale. Gid Hershoff with Mr. Breer. Parts for sale out of the trunk of a car. And the judges were beginning to do their inspection. This lady had a nicely styled dress, very apropos to the function. And more parts for sale. Beautiful coupe. Again, they're all lined up. Now, these are some movies that I took with my 8mm camera, And after you transfer them onto videotape, they weren't too sharp, but at least we have a record of the occasion. Nowadays, one can get much better pictures with a video camera directly on tape, especially if you use one of the high band formats like Super VHS. And this is what I use now. But I'll soon be going to a new type camera that takes digital video with a horizontal resolution of 500 lines, which is even better than Super VHS. The cars are all lined up here getting ready for inspection. This chap is cleaning his back seat out to get everything spick and span. These cars are inspected by a committee of six or seven judges who carefully check all the details and award them ratings in their particular class. The back row of cars there are all the airflows getting ready for that inspection. This fellow brought a Chrysler, but it wasn't an airflow. I think it was one of the Airstreams of the same era. And this young lad had a real fine little toy automobile. Mr. Ged Hershoff here with Dad was one of his right-hand men, and he did a lot of work in perfecting the airflow. He worked closely with Dad. Fred Rieger putting the finishing touches on his car. He owned a very successful business in Dayton. These cars came from all over the map. I was intrigued with the locations by photographing all these license plates. Some of them came a long way. Another shot of the parts for sale. They were doing a very active business. People had to keep their cars in shape, and some of these parts are even remanufactured. Dad is looking over one of those instruction booklets, which in his captions in his photo album said that he bought that particular one. Another picture of Mr. Breer with the CW in front of his Grosse Pointe residence. This sixth annual meet was held in Ann Arbor, Michigan, but included a day's visit to the large Chrysler Proving Ground in nearby Chelsea, as shown here. We get a close-up look at all the members of the club who attended. A picture of Dad posing with one of his creations. Another picture that included what looks like a Plymouth Roadrunner, the hot rod of its day. And a view of the CW, which originally belonged to John Hartford, one of the two brothers who owned and operated the chain of A&P food stores. Toby Kucher, my son Carl Breer II, and Dad in the back seat of the CW. Now, these were some more of my movies taken by a regular 8mm film camera and then transferred to videotape. The picture quality isn't so great, but again, at least it provided a record. Toby Kucher, the fellow on the left, was one of the original engineers in charge of road test. Gid Hirschhoff in the middle and Dad on the right. The person on the extreme right of this picture is my son, Carl Breer II. Everybody's getting their cars in position for the inspectors to go over. What a beautiful row of automobiles. Inspector's giving this car the once-over. And that certainly was a beautiful display in front of that car that he'd provided, showing photographs of his car and a newspaper article on it. View from the balcony of the motel. I can well remember how much Dad enjoyed attending this affair, the sincere dedication club members demonstrated in preserving their airflow cars and history behind them gave Dad a great feeling of satisfaction.